Today I'm testing a bunch of SFX power supplies in the 450 to 750 watt range against the new RTX 3080. And as many of you know, this is an incredibly fast GPU, but it also chugs back a ton of power. So what does that mean for users who are running 600 watt power supplies, for example, and are planning to make the upgrade to this GPU, at least when the cards come back in stock? So that's the question that we're going to be answering today. If you do have a 600 watt power supply, which I feel is fairly common, is that enough to run the RTX 3080? But also, what other things do you need to consider? So the main question that we want to answer today, does the RTX 3080 require a power supply beyond 600 watts? Now, the official power supply recommendation for the RTX 3080 from Nvidia and board partners is at least a 750 watt unit. But a lot of you are probably wondering whether you can get away with a 600 watt unit that you might currently have in your system, and whether this is actually something that you need to upgrade. After all, it could mean just throwing away money that doesn't need to be spent. I also feel that 600 watt units are very, very common, especially if your system is RTX and you probably have one of the incredibly popular Corsair SF600s. So here are the power supplies that we'll be testing. We have the Corsair SF450, two SF600s, one is the 80 plus gold model and the other is the 80 plus platinum model. Then we have the Corsair SF750, then the 650 watt pre-installed power supply in the NZXT H1. These are fairly common power supplies, but they're also maybe just on the edge of what can be used with the RTX 3080. Now, your GPU will almost always be the single most power-hungry piece of hardware in your system, but your CPU also plays a huge role here too. Whether you're running a 65-watt CPU or a 300-watt CPU, it could potentially be the tipping point for a 600 watt power supply when paired with the RTX 3080. The gaming test bench that I use for GPU testing is a perfect example of this. It uses an Intel 10900K with all 10 cores overclocked to 5.1 GHz at 1.3 volts, and with these settings, it has the potential to easily pull over 280 watts on its own in something like Cinebench or Blender, and upwards of 200 watts during a CPU intensive game. At stock though, the 10900K won't pull any more than 230 watts during short duration loads, or any more than 125 watts during sustained loads like rendering. Most 8 to 10 core CPUs will most likely sit around that 125 watt range with power limits enforced. Now, before we go ahead and plug in these power supplies to see which ones will work and which ones won't work with the RTX 3080, it's important to establish a worst case scenario in terms of power consumption, where power consumption is pushed the highest in a particular workload. So here's what we're looking at across a few games, and do note that GPU power itself is pretty even across all of these titles, between 330 and 340 watts, but it's the CPU power that's to blame for the differences that we see here. Also, these results were taken during static scenes, but when actually moving around in game, it's typically around 30 to 50 watts higher than these values, at least with the overclocked 10900K that we've used here. So Battlefield 5 demonstrates the most power draw out of all of these titles here, and that does make sense seeing as it is a CPU intensive title and requires the most CPU load in this list. In fact, we can further increase this power draw by lowering the resolution from 4K to 1440p, which will still have the RTX 3080 at 100% utilization, but increases the CPU utilization a significant amount, pushing us up to 565 watts at the wall. Again, this was measured during a static scene, but when moving around, this actually spiked up to as much as 630 watts. Now, when we run our 10900K at stock, we can reduce the overall power draw while gaming by around 20 to 30 watts, and that's enough to bring all of the 4K gaming results here under 500 watts total. So now that we have a bigger picture of power draw under a range of conditions, let's take a look at which of these power supplies will and won't run the RTX 3080, and I've got to say these were some very surprising results. in a good way. To test these units, I took the worst case scenario from our power consumption tests, which was Battlefield 5 running at 1440p alongside a reasonably overclocked 10900K. I then played for at least 30 minutes to see if the power supplies would trip. That means if the power supply can't provide enough power to the system, it will trigger a full system reset. So firstly, the 750 watt Corsair SF750. This plain and simply ran with no issues at all. The fan did start spinning at a low RPM, but it was by no means loud. This is an easy pass. Then next we have the pre-installed 650 watt power supply in the NZXT H1, which is called the S650, and this also ran with no issues. The fan was a bit louder here though, and this would definitely be audible in the NZXT H1. But now we get to the 600 watt units from Corsair, the SF600s, and surprisingly, both the 80 plus gold and 80 plus platinum model here passed without tripping. During the test, I saw power consumption spike well over 600 watts, so it's interesting to see that both of these units could support both the RTX 3080 and an overclocked 10900K without a problem. And as most of you probably could have guessed, the 450 watt SF450 didn't stand much of a chance. It did boot into Windows without a problem, but unfortunately I couldn't load up any games. By removing the CPU overclock though, games did launch, but the system would completely reset once the game actually started rendering. So 600 watts is absolutely fine, and that is especially the case when you consider that most of you are not running overclocked 10900Ks, but more like Ryzen 5, Ryzen 7s, or generally CPUs around the 100 to max 150 watt range, not like 200 watts plus like we used in the test. Now, I've also had a ton of questions on undervolting the RTX 3080 and how much you could potentially reduce power consumption and thermals for the GPU, and the answer is not much. Since the clock speed of the 3080 is so high, especially for these aftermarket cards, which typically sit around 1950 megahertz or higher, you just can't run that frequency at a significantly lower voltage. It's just like CPUs, higher frequencies require higher voltages, so if you really do want to undervolt the RTX 3080 for whatever reason, then you will need to drop the frequency as well. I was able to step the voltage down to 950 millivolts on the ASUS RTX 3080 Tough OC before encountering any crashes. That saved us around 30 watts in power consumption, a couple of degrees, and a slightly lower fan RPM. But overall, it's probably not worth doing unless you are really challenged by thermals and power, which is unlikely. So some really good results to see here, and it's great to know that for those of you running a decent quality 600 watt power supply, you do not need to make the upgrade to a higher output unit if you're considering the RTX 3080. Don't get me wrong, higher output units are definitely still recommended. They will run quieter after all and may give you some more peace of mind. And for those of you building a new system from the ground up, I would definitely recommend going with at least a 750 watt unit moving forward. Otherwise, for the rest of you running 600 watt power supplies in your system, that seems to be absolutely fine for the RTX 3080, even when accompanied with 200 watts plus of CPU power. As always, a huge thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one.